hope you're all well, and welcome to our family home in Nottingham. These are my brothers and sisters.
Hello!
These lockdown days have been hard for all of us. But imagine being stuck in a house, seven brothers and sisters and one of their mates. It could be total hell. But not for them. This is a house like no other. This is the Kane Mason family, back home for lockdown with their parents, Stuart and Caddy. Each one of these siblings is an extraordinary musician. The third son, Sheku, became known to the world after hundreds of millions watched him play at the wedding of Meghan Markle and Prince Harry.
Okay, I think we're live. Hello, everyone.
But with the pandemic came cancelled concerts and closed schools. They seized this unique situation, and with nothing more than their mobile phones, they've been streaming live across the internet from their house in Nottingham. Entertaining millions, bringing people together from across the globe, inspiring them with their infectious take on life and love of classical music. Working within the safety restrictions of lockdown, we've been able to connect with the family.
My name's Brima.
Brima, yeah.
I'm Amanata.
Mariachu.
Yeah. Jennifer.
Konya, yeah. Isata.
Sheku. And get to know them and hear them play like never before.
Hey, another level again, Jennifer.
That was like... Oh, yeah, that's... Yeah.
The day started with a piece close to their hearts, the African-American spiritual Deep River, originally set to piano by Samuel Coleridge Taylor.
We made this arrangement
and it really resonated with us, not just because we loved the tune, but also because Samuel Coleridge Taylor is from Sierra Leone, which is where our mum was born. So when we also found that out, it was obviously a very special connection, and we've just really enjoyed playing it since. Yeah.
Thank you. This talent hasn't come out of nowhere. The unassuming ease of this family. You'd never guess what they've been up to over the years. Isata and Jennifer have both been keyboard finalists of BBC Young Musician, while Sheku made history in 2016 by becoming the first ever black competitor to take the top prize. The same year, Brymer appeared on Top of the Pops with Clean Bandit's Christmas number one, Rockabye. And then Sheku broke more ground with his album Elgar, which he recorded with Sir Simon Rattle and the London Symphony Orchestra, becoming the first ever cellist in chart history to land a top 10 place in the UK official album charts, the first classical instrumentalist in over 30 years. Okay, so tell me, how are you all getting on? You're not exactly self-isolating, are you? Look at you. So how have you found it?
I mean, it was a bit crazy at first because we're not used to being this many people in the house for such a long period of time. And of course, you can only go out, you know, for your daily exercise. And apart from that, you're kind of here. Luckily, we have a garden and a table tennis table, and that also helped a lot in the beginning. Yeah.
It's really happy for me because they're all away at London and I'm really lonely and they all come back, so it's really lovely, yeah.
Well, we're really lucky because, of course, we've got all our children back with us. So for me, I mean, it's wonderful. When we first arrived, of course, it was difficult for them because all their concerts for months were being cancelled. But we had each other, so which was a bonus.
Yeah, and so they've settled into a nice routine. So there's the seven of them, and then they also, a flatmate of the boys, Plinio, is also here. You know, they play a lot of music, they go for walks, you know, they play in the garden. So they've been working very, very hard. So it's actually become quite a nice dynamic.
Now, Plinio, what are you doing here, Plinio? You're a lodger, is that right?
What are you doing here?
You're a lodger with the guitar.
Indeed.
Yeah. How did you get to know this lot?
Okay, so basically, me and Isata, we are in the same year at the Royal Academy of Music, so we started the undergrad together. And then 2 years later, Brima came, and then the following year, Sheku came. So like we moved together to a flat. So me, Brima, and Sheku, we share a flat in London. Yeah, so like this environment here is kind of very familiar because, you know, that's what we do at home when we are there. We just practice loads, we rehearse with each other.
I don't think Plinio actually expected to be here for this long.
True, it's really true.
But also, I suppose lots of other opportunities have come out of it because they've played lots of different duos and ensembles, which definitely wouldn't have happened if we hadn't have had all this time together.
My sister and I, so Isata, we've been doing a project to try and learn all of the Chopin etudes, and this is actually one of my favourites. The melody just really speaks to me.
Chopin said that he could never come up with a melody more beautiful than this one.
And I love the key of E major as well because it's really bright and sings.
Sounding so
I mean,
nice.
Looking in just now, kind of a bit. Mom, I blame you and your parcels. No, he was on a rush.
Mom, it's actually you and your Amazon.
I blame you, Mum.
We have to blame you. That was sounding really lovely, Jem. That was sounding really lovely.
Yeah.
So I don't think it's a matter.
Okay, goodbye.
This family's approach to music is so unexpected. For them, classical sits just as happily alongside every other genre.
When they grew up, we played everything. So we played classical music, we played reggae music, we played country and western, we played rap, we played rock. And we've always said it's just music, really. And so I think, you know, when Shaku did his album, yes, it was centered around Shostakovich. But for him, it was very natural to play, you know, No Woman, No Cry, Bob Marley, or Leonard Cohen's Hallelujah. And I think that's how music should be. It needs to evolve and be inclusive.
I guess the musicians that you first listen to somehow stick with you for the longest.
Yeah.
When did you first hear Bob Marley?
Probably before I was born. So I think, yeah, he's a favourite of our parents as well.
So when you're in your mother's stomach, that's when you first heard Bob Marley, was it?
Before that, you were nothing.
My first words were No Woman, No Cry. I think he's one of the most inspiring musicians I've come across and listened to, because of how he connects love and all of these things to music and the idea of sharing and moving people with music. And I've always been inspired by that idea.
Your extraordinary cello, a 400-year-old Amati, tell me about that and what's so special about it.
Yeah, I'm so, so lucky to be able to play an instrument like this. Has such a wonderful sound, a kind of, I don't know, a kind of brown sugar sweet tone, which I really enjoy exploring.
Mariatu, what was it like listening to Shaku play the cello?
It was lovely to hear Shaku play. It was really inspiring, especially for BBC Young Musician. That's when I really thought, I prefer this than the violin.
And I read somewhere, Mariatu, that when Sheka, one, you were 6 years old at that time, and you said, I think I could play the cello better than him.
Well, maybe I could if I practice really well and really try my best. Because he's giving me loads of lessons, so I'm taking up all the feedback and trying to get better than him. So.
I really do like Valspace by Frank Bridge because it has a kind of painful sound and has so many emotions in it, which I really like.
This pandemic has cut a sway through the careers of performers everywhere. But the one thing musicians must do is share their music. Luckily for the Kane Masons' neighbours, that happens to be on the street where they live.
Actually, I think all of our neighbours seem to really appreciate music.
Mm. When we do the NHS clap on Thursdays, these guys have been playing a bit of klezmer on the street.
Yeah, also our neighbour Vicky Manderson joins in with us, playing the clarinet, which is really lovely.
Mm-hmm. I think that's really kind of brought everyone together as a community in these times when everyone's social distancing and isolating. I think to be able to hear music, it's a really good tool. I think we as humans really need to be creative. And I think when you have a platform where you can be creative, it not only brings you closer to other people, teaches you empathy, it also kind of helps your general emotional state in all areas of life, really.
has been a very long time since any of us have last done a concert in front of an audience, and in front of a live audience, and I can definitely say I really, really miss performing, and I miss being in a concert hall and sharing music with an audience. So we've been trying to make the most of what we can do.
For Plinio, making music with his adopted family has an added poignancy. His own family is 6,000 miles away in Brazil, where the pandemic has reached epic proportions.
Being away from Brazil now is quite tricky, because I just follow the news via internet, and I see that things are going pretty badly. Luckily, my family are safe. When Sheik and Brahma returned to Nottingham, it was a really kind and lovely invitation from their parents for me to come back with them and join the crew and be like an eighth sibling in the house.
As flatmates in London, Sheku and Plinio have been experimenting with music for cello and guitar. It's an unusual combination with limited repertoire. Their duo has inspired some surprising arrangements.
So Sheku came to me, he gave me the score, this arrangement of Scarborough Fair, and it was lovely. My connection with Scarborough Fair comes from a long way, because my parents loved the song. Since I came to England and listening to English folk songs and to English music, they actually reminded me of that. And I think it's an extraordinarily beautiful piece, yeah. Thank you.
It's wonderful to have a garden. But I can't help thinking that with eight musicians living under the same roof, how can they find enough space and time to keep match fit?
Ister, the oldest, you know, practices 5, 6, 7 hours a day. And when people say to her, you know, gosh, that's a lot of practice. But then she says, well, people go to work for 8, 9 hours a day and nobody questions that. So, you know, for her, it's a job she loves.
Yeah. I suppose because everybody's practicing, that's easier, actually. There's a sense that you're not alone.
How do you manage to organise yourselves?
The pianists have a rotation with the pianos. And then everyone else kind of practices in bathrooms, bedrooms, yeah. And then wherever you can really get anywhere.
Go on. So bathrooms, what about the kitchen?
No.
No one ever goes.
Yeah.
Not
yeah.
yet.
Yeah. 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 Our mum wouldn't allow it.
Yeah. How many pianos do you have?
We have 4 pianos.
Four pianos.
Our normal pianos that we have, there's only one good piano. So actually, they're always fighting over the one good piano. We've been very fortunate during the lockdown that Bechstein have loaned us 3 wonderful pianos, 2 amazing uprights, and a grand piano. And it's just...
Oh, it's changed
everything. It's yes.
What, aren't you going to miss it? When it...
Yes.
A lot. We're
terribly,
really,
yeah.
We're really
yeah.
attached to it already.
Yeah.
For any pianist to play on a thoroughbred piano is irresistible. For Konya, this was a chance to try out the more idiosyncratic side of her repertoire.
So I found out about the Bartok Suite Opus 14 fairly recently. Today I'll be playing the first movement. It's quite a quirky short piece. There's lots of humour and banter in it, which I think quite relates to my personality quite a bit. So I think in some ways I have a bit of an affinity with this piece.
Lucky because they went to an amazing primary school, Walter Hawes Primary School, and then on to Trinity Catholic School. And the school was passionate about music. Music was very much part of the curriculum, central to the curriculum. And it made all the children equal and made them part of a family for academic children and non-academic children as well.
And it's in terms of where the period we're going through and the economy and where it's going to be, one worries really about education and music and the arts for young people, particularly those in state education.
Yes, I think it's absolutely central and should be there for everyone. And if it's taken away, I think the consequences for all children will be terrible. Music is something that everyone can access, and it's so important for your mental health, for your, just for your intelligence.
Yeah, and sense of confidence and creativity and collaboration and teamwork and enjoyment in life. So I think it's really, really important.
Yes, for our children it has been.
Wow, it's fine. He's in here.
That sense of enjoyment in life is palpable in this house, where storytelling and imagination infuses their whole approach to playing music.
So I've chosen to play the Chopin D minor prelude, and Chopin basically wrote 24 preludes, and there's been lots of kind of speculation as to what they're about. But my favourite one is the notion that basically the preludes are a journey through a person's life, starting with, you know, birth, which was the C major one, the first one, and ending with death. And death is the one that I'm playing, so it's in D minor, which is often thought to be the key of death. And it's a very kind of turbulent, kind of agitated piece. And it ends with these three really loud Ds, which I think is meant to signal the person dying. So it's quite a dark piece, but I like dark pieces.
Taken the family to Antigua just about every year. What is it about Antigua and how do they see that part of their DNA, their history?
I mean, there are children of sort of mixed heritage, if you like. There's Sierra Leone, there's Wales, and there's Antigua. And my parents are back in Antigua. We used to take them when they were young on holiday, but more recently, they've been going to Antigua by invitation, doing concerts in schools, and they've also been coaching children. And Antigua and Barbuda has set up a youth orchestra, and it's a lovely thing to be part of.
So our next piece, we go on to a composer called Grieg, and it's a piece called Hall of the Mountain King, which goes something like this.
I think it's always really interesting when very young children who haven't really had many experiences with classical music, they all respond to it in a really direct way. And I think that's really amazing. And it just shows how powerful, you know, a simple rhythm or melody or harmony, they all kind of understand major is kind of this feeling and simple, and then minor, they all kind of understand that.
I think also there's a real thing going around that classical music is only accessible to certain people and that it's like this and blah, blah, blah. And I think when we go to places like Antigua or to any school and play music to young people, when you see how they react to it, you realise that that's completely not true and that, you know, it really is accessible to everyone.
Yeah.
Demystifying classical music is something the whole family relishes. They've always done it. Finding stories as a way to the heart of a piece. And when it comes to the romance of Rachmaninoff, their imagination has plenty to play with.
For me, it's my favourite piano and cello sonata, and I've wanted to play it for years. Now, we've chosen the second movement because it's a very exciting movement. We have this whole story of the movement about... Anyway, I won't go into
the whole story.
I won't tell the whole story.
Oh, go on. Carry on.
Well, I mean, it makes more sense when you hear the piece, but basically, so a horse is pulling a carriage and inside there's a mum, a dad and a child. And then there's some animal chasing this horse and carriage.
It's
muddy, it's like dark and it's rainy. And then the rhythm's da-da-da-da-da. So we made that, we're coming after you. So that's the animal. And then the piano answers da-da-da, which is don't look back, da-da. Then the middle section's my dear.
Because they're trying to comfort the child so they're not scared. So the whole piece is really kind of dramatic and you imagine this kind of chase through a dark forest. And then the nice middle section is basically the parents singing to the child, trying to comfort them, which will make more sense when you hear the piece.
Hopefully.
Thank you.
Amazing. Amazing.
What's maybe special about music is it can communicate to lots of different people. Everyone has their own personal response to a piece of music, but it's always understandable on some level. That's what makes it so inclusive.
Doing something, and when you all have something in common, it naturally bonds you together as people because you all understand what the other person's going through, etc.
Yeah. Yeah.
Music teaches you so much more than just learning an instrument. It has listening, perseverance, hard work, whether you want to pursue music as a career or just for fun.
Started and it took me a while to get into it, but if you're dedicated to it and it becomes natural, almost like breathing, so I think it's really, really enjoyable thing to do.
I have something really good to say. I think music is such a great way of explaining everyday life in a way that words can't. And in this time where we're not living in normal life, it's such a great way to keep in touch with that. We've been kept sane by playing music together.
Kind of helps your general emotional state in all areas of life, really.
Mm. Especially in like long car journeys, just sticking to the phones and just listening to the music. That
exactly.
This amazing day ends with a medley from the musical Fiddler on the Roof, which the Carnot Masons arranged themselves while in lockdown.
Did you all love that musical?
Yeah, so yeah. I think it was one of our favourite musicals growing up. We watched it a lot. So when we were thinking about, you know, new medleys to have for all of us so that we didn't have to just play Shardas forever, this came to mind.
I can remember when I was 7, I just started the violin. I remember the violin solo just being really, really inspired and trying to play it. Like, I couldn't, but I did. Yeah.
I also liked The Fiddler on the Roof because I love musicals because I like acting. And I have singing lessons, so I really liked playing that, yeah.
Inspiration, I think, is such an important thing, and I think if you see someone who looks like you and is doing something to a high level, that can be one of the most inspiring things. Yeah, that's one of the main aims of what we try to do as musicians.